kids are going to stay here with us today. It is a family Sunday, the fifth Sunday of the month. But to aid them and help them and learn as well in our services this morning, there's a special children's bulletin. Did all your kids who want one of those get those? If not, Gary has them somewhere. Okay, and just some special things in there to help them focus in on the Word this morning. So let's turn our Bibles to Matthew. Yes, Matthew, chapter 8. Matthew chapter 8. I'm going to go to the Lord in prayer and asking Him to guide our time in the Word this morning. Father, we thank You for Your Word. Lord, we thank You for its guidance. I pray that You would open our hearts to receive it this morning. In Your name I pray. Amen. Well, how do you think God views you? Based on what you know in the Scriptures of who God is, when He looks at you, you personally, He looks at me, what does He see? What is conjured up within Him as He looks at you? There's a cool story over in Matthew chapter 8 here where Jesus, He responds to a man, and I would love for Jesus to make the same response to me. Okay, and so let's look and see what Jesus is doing here in Matthew chapter 8. When he had entered Capernaum, verse 5 is where we're at. When he had entered Capernaum, a centurion came forward to him, appealing to him. Okay? This is Jesus' early part of his ministry. He's been ministering around the Sea of Galilee, the lake. Okay? And we've been in the book of Mark and seeing Jesus work over there. Matthew focuses in on that time, but he gives us some more information about what was happening and what Jesus was doing. And he tells this story here of a centurion who came before the Lord. Now, what nationality was a centurion? Any guesses here?
Roman,
very good. Roman. He's a Roman guy. Now, he wasn't a Jew, okay? He was from who knows where in the empire, but he was stationed there. He was a Roman centurion. That might be of benefit for some kids who are here today, maybe taking notes that he was a centurion, okay? And so, he's Roman. He's not a Jew. But this centurion, he has a problem. Verse 6. Lord, my servant is lying paralyzed at home, suffering terribly. Wow, this would be a centurion that I wouldn't mind working for. He has a compassion on his servant there who is paralyzed. And so he wants Jesus to come and heal him. And Jesus says, okay, I'll go. Verse 7, I will come and heal him. Now this centurion has faith, right, that Jesus can heal his servant, okay? But he has a remarkable faith that leaves Jesus astounded. Look what happens in verses 8 and 9. The centurion replied, Lord, I am not worthy to have you come under my roof, but only say the word and my servant will be healed, for I too am a man under authority, with soldiers under me, and I say to one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this, and he does it. Now that's some faith, right? People knew that Jesus could heal, but this guy says, you know, I'm not even worthy. I'm a Roman, not a Jew. You are a great teacher here. Don't even come to my house just because you're far above me. And he realizes something about authority. Because he's a guy who's accountable to his commander, right? You've got to follow orders. The guys underneath him got to follow his orders. And he thinks if Jesus is a kind of authority that has authority to heal people, he could just say the word, boom, and it's going to be done. And so he trusts that Jesus would do this. Now what's Jesus' response to all this? It's in verse 10. When Jesus heard this, he what? He marveled and said to those who followed him, truly I tell you, with no one in Israel have I found such faith. He marveled. All right, because he was the one who was not supposed to believe, right? He's Roman, okay? Jesus came, he was ministering among the Jews. It was the Jews who had the scriptures that would point to the fact that a Messiah is coming, he would do great things, heal, miracles, all that. The Jews should have been the ones believing and had the strong faith, but it was this guy, this Roman guy, and all he knew was that Jesus had authority, and he believed. And Jesus says, boy, nowhere in Israel have I found such faith. This guy is the last guy who should have been believing, but he was one of the first and believed the most intently and left Jesus, what? Amazed. Now, I would love for God to look at me and say, Jonathan, wow, I'm amazed at your faith, all right? Because I think Jesus shows that faith is something that can be virtuous here in this way. That where Jesus looks at me, I'd like him just to be amazed at how I respond to things in life in complete faith. Or maybe I only have $7.43 in my bank account. My payday is not till next week. All right, but I don't fear, I don't worry. My faith is strong that God is going to provide as He has promised to do. I would love for that faith to be true about me. Or maybe I would love it to be true that I was sitting with somebody who lost a family member, who is grieving. Instead of fearing for them, I know that the God of all comfort is going to show up in a real way. I have a strong faith. Or maybe a coworker asks me or you to tell more about Jesus. And yeah, you're nervous, but you have a strong faith that God's going to give you the words. Okay? And that you respond to whatever situation that comes up in faith that God would fulfill His promises. I want Jesus to look at my faith and be amazed. How about you? Do you want that this morning? And here's our big idea. It asks the question that forces us to evaluate our faith. Is Jesus amazed by you? Is Jesus, starts with a J for you kids in here, Jesus amazed by you? And though we've been in the book of Mark, or in the book of Matthew, let's go back to Mark as we continue this theme of Jesus responding with amazement to faith. Okay, and we're going to get to our section here in Mark chapter 6. Or in Mark chapter 6. So Jesus has been doing some amazing things. Okay, He's calmed the storm. He's cast out a demon out of a guy. He healed a woman who had been sick for 12 years. And the little girl, what did Jesus do for the little girl? Remember last week? Yeah, He rose her from the dead, okay? She was dead and He made her alive. And that's Jesus. Does that sound like a God who we can trust? I think it does, all right? A Jesus who is still alive today. So we get to verse 1 as the narrative continues here. And it says this, Mark 6, verse 1. He, Jesus, went away from there and came to His hometown, and His disciples followed Him. Okay? All Jesus' ministry has been around a lake, a sea. There's the Sea of Galilee. And now Jesus leaves there and goes somewhere else. Okay, where does He go? His hometown. And do we know what His hometown is? Yes, very good. Nazareth. It's not Bethlehem. Okay, that's where He was born. Nazareth is where He's from. The kids might appreciate that little tidbit as well. And so He's from Nazareth. Okay? And although Nazareth is kind of famous today, back in Jesus' day, that was a small town. Scholars estimate about 500 people, okay? And Jesus began His ministry when He was about 30 years old. Okay, 30, okay? That means that He lived in Nazareth. He went from Bethlehem to Egypt and moved to Nazareth as a young boy. He's probably lived there for 26, 27 years, okay, in Nazareth. Now, in a town of 500 people, if you're living there for 26, 27 years, do you think you're going to know a few people? Yeah, probably. I mean, you think you'll know everybody? Probably. Because, I mean, we have a small town here. We know a lot of people. But we can drive. If you want to go shopping or somewhere, you can drive to DeKalb, Peru, Rochelle, Mendota. Back in this day, did people travel the way we do today? No. Everything they needed, they got in their town for the most part. Okay? So they stayed close. And so they would have known each other. And so Jesus goes back to His hometown to people that He knows and that know Him. And that's important. Okay? So, He goes home and it's not just for vacation. He says He brings His disciples with Him. He's there for ministry. Okay? And so, Jesus is going back, though, differently than He left. Okay? There's a big difference. Turn over to a few pages to the book, to Mark chapter 1. Just there, probably two or three pages before Mark chapter 1. Mark tells us how Jesus started His ministry. Mark 1:9. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Okay? And it was from that time, verse 14, it says, He began to preach the kingdom of God, repent and believe in the gospel. So, Jesus leaves Nazareth and then He starts His ministry, right? He didn't grow up with a healing booth when He was a teenager in Nazareth. Okay? That started after He left. So although Jesus was sinless whenever He was living in Nazareth, He didn't do the preaching, He didn't do the miracles. He was kind of just one of the people of the village. That started after He left. And now He's coming back. And now He has a following. He has disciples. He has the fame before Him. Okay? And how do you think the people are going to welcome Him now? I mean, if I went back home, I'd love it for the people that I grew up with to welcome Him back with open arms. And let's see if the people do that. Look at verse 2. And on the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue. And many who heard him were astonished, saying, "Where did this man get these things? What is the wisdom given to him? How are such mighty works done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. And Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor except in his hometown and among his relatives and in his own household." So Jesus gets up there in the synagogue and does what he usually does. He teaches. But instead of people responding, as happens often, they turn against him. And they start to ask different things. They're astonished by him. And this isn't surprising in a good way. It's like, "Oh, look what Jesus can do." Now it's more like, "Oh, look what Jesus can do." All right? You ever been astonished in a kind of a negative way and felt that? I remember I went to Bible college, and at Bible college you study, well, the Bible. Most of the people that were there were going to ministry somehow, some way. And I remember after graduation, I was watching the news a few years after my graduation, and I saw a classmate of mine on the news. Okay, it showed a mugshot of him on the news, where he was living at this apartment building, climbed through the ductwork, and was spying on his little lady friend, neighbor next door, the guy I went to school with, who was claimed to be a Christian to follow the Bible. When I saw that, I was shocked. I was surprised. Another guy I went to school with was a leader in our dorm. And it turns out a few years after he left, he became an agnostic and against the things of the Lord. I was surprised when I heard that in sorrow. And I think that's what the people of Nazareth were doing here with Jesus. They were surprised. They didn't get it. And they were somewhat disappointed. And they want to know where Jesus is getting these things. It says, "Where did this man get these things? What is the wisdom given to him? How are such mighty works done by his hands?" Do you remember what Nathanael said about when he was in the book of John about the people from Nazareth? He says this, Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Sounds like there's some prejudice from Nathanael about the people from Nazareth. Well, apparently the people of Nazareth believe this too, okay? Because Jesus came from us, okay? How can anything good come out of us? And so they dismiss him there. And they say he can't do great things. Is not this the carpenter? Now, being a carpenter is an honorable profession, but these people aren't using it honorably here, okay? Because carpenters, they work with wood and measure and saws and things like that, or whatever they had back in the day. And now he's preaching and teaching. No, carpenters don't do that. This is not something that makes sense to us. And this is just an aside here. Jesus was a carpenter, right? Okay, he probably picked up this trade in his teens, okay, and practiced it for 10, 12, 15, 16 years, right? Carpenter. Has anybody ever known a carpenter? I have a few carpenters here, okay. What do carpenters look like? Do they have like these like oil of Olay smooth skin? Right, where you just like as smooth as a baby's bottom, right? It's what they're handsome, right? are they these wimpy guys usually? No, they got to move wood around. They're usually strong guys, okay? And back in Jesus' day, did they have Menards or Lowe's or Home Depot? No, you want wood, you go get it from the tree, all right? And so these are guys that worked hard. And so maybe this is just a bit more of my opinion, and so you can take this or leave this. But as I read the scriptures, it doesn't sound like this is Jesus here, okay? Where you have like the mystical-looking Jesus, the one who has the baby smooth skin and kind of weak. Now, I say this just as an aside because it's probably a bit more of an opinion, but when I see this Jesus, it seems like there's a lot of separation between me and this guy. Like, that guy's not one of us. Okay, he's something different and mystical. And as the Bible portrays Jesus in his ministry, the point is that he is one of us. Okay? Isaiah tells him there was nothing about his physical appearance that would draw us to him. Okay? He worked hard. He was one of us. And yes, he was perfect, but he was tempted in every way that we were, except without sin. And that's the point, that he became one of us so that he could die for us. And I think if we get in the mind that who Jesus really was, it puts Jesus that much closer to us. Okay? End opinion. Back to the text. All right? So these Nazarenes dismiss Jesus. He's just a guy from Nazareth. He's just a carpenter. Okay? And they even know his family. Okay? Is not this the son of Mary, brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us? this guy can't be anything special. We know his family. It's right over here, okay? And this family didn't believe in him yet at this point. We covered that a couple chapters ago. But a couple of them do. You see the word James here? That's the same guy who wrote the book of James. Jude, same guy who wrote the book of Jude here. They eventually believe, but they don't now. He also has sisters here. And so they make all these excuses for why they can't believe in him. And they all culminates at the end of verse 3 and says, they took offense at him. They were offended that somebody they knew would have the gall to stand up and say, I'm the Messiah. Okay? Because experts always come from out of town. Right? If a company hires a consultant, do they do it within their company? No, they find somebody elsewhere who they can trust, right? And so they look on Jesus with suspicion because they think they have him figured out. But these are the people that grew up with Jesus. Of all the people that should have believed, these people should have, because they would have seen the way he lived his life up to that point. All right, but they don't. They turn their back. They don't trust. And that causes Jesus to say a prophet is not without honor except in his hometown. So Jesus goes home. The people don't accept him and instead are astonished. The ones that were supposed to accept him reject him. And when we begin, look at verses 5 to see what Jesus' response is here. It says he could do no mighty work there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. He was amazed that the people that should have believed him did not. And as we began our sermon, I asked you, okay, is Jesus amazed by you? Now, as we learn with the centurion, he can be amazed at strong faith, but he can also equally be amazed by the absence of it and people that should believe and then choose not to. So is Jesus amazed by you? Well, today we're sitting here in a church, right, where most of us call ourselves Christians, okay? What are the first 6 letters of the word Christian? I counted them. Christ. Okay? We claim to follow Jesus. We claim to obey him. We're supposed to be passionate about him. And maybe we can do that pretty well on Sunday and maybe Wednesday, but what about the rest of the week? As we live our lives, are we followers of Jesus? Do we live before him in faith? And as we live our lives throughout the week, is Jesus amazed at how we interact with our lives in faith, or is he amazed by the lack of it that we display throughout our week? And sadly, I think there's many who claim to follow Christ that if you looked at their lives then, they don't take those opportunities to trust the Lord. Okay? I know that's true because it's been true of me sometimes. Okay? When I know what the Word says, but whatever situation comes up, it's just hard to take God at His Word in that moment. I'm supposed to believe, but for whatever reason, I just don't in that moment. I think there's some common sins, though, and behaviors that Christians have that have their roots in not believing Jesus. Okay, I want to talk about 3 of them here. Okay, 3 things that can replace our faith in him that can challenge us this morning. Okay, and the kids, maybe you want to take note about this, okay, in your bulletins as well. Think of worry. Worry. Christians can be good worriers sometimes, can't we? I mean, we worry about money, we worry about health, we worry about what others think of us, we worry about where our country's going, we worry about if we put on an extra pound over the holidays. Okay, there's ample things to be worried about. But what does our worry say about our faith in God? Because if we're worrying, what are we not doing? We're not exercising faith, we are not trusting Him. Think of it like this. Earlier this week, David was up, our little one-year-old. Okay, and at the breakfast table, some of the kids had eaten their cereal, and they had shredded wheat that morning. Okay, now what does shredded wheat look like after it's been partially eaten by a 2-year-old? Okay, you got a full bowl of milk there because she poured too much on, and then it's got the clumpy shredded wheat leftovers in there. Okay, it's kind of gross, I'm going to be honest. And so David thought he'd crawl up on the table, pull that off, and he'd march it back to our bedroom. Okay, and I'm over by my closet and look back at the doorway, and there's David sauntering in there with this full bowl of shredded wheat muck. And in that moment, I worry. Oh no, he's going to spill it on the carpet, okay? Because David has shown that he's not trustworthy when it comes to carrying things or carrying himself, okay? He's a toddler, and he toddles around, he falls on his rear all day long. And so I worry that the bowl is going to hit the ground and all that stuff is going to be over the carpet. And that's not just milk, it's the gunk of whatever was left over in there. So I don't trust him, and therefore I worry. But what if, same bowl, Sarah walks through the door carrying that thing? Am I going to be worried and freak out? No, Sarah's a big girl. She's shown that she's trustworthy and doesn't fall over all day long, okay? And so I'd be like, I don't know what you're doing with it. It's gross, but I can trust you to carry it around the house, okay? But what if I turn to Sarah and I treat her as if she's David? All right, how insulting would that be to her? Like, Sarah, you're going to drop it. Okay, she'd be like, come on. I won't say how old you are, sorry. I'm an adult. Let's say it that way. I'm an adult. Okay, you can trust me to do this. But how often in our lives do we treat God like he's the toddler? Where something happens and we're worried about something, we freak out worrying that, oh no, something bad is going to happen. We don't trust God to take care of it. We don't respond to God like he's the creator, the one who is in charge of this whole world. We respond to him as somebody who's weak and powerless, and therefore we worry. But instead, God says a few things about how he's involved in our lives. Hebrews 13:5, I will never leave you nor forsake you. That's a promise, okay, from Christ here. I will never leave you nor forsake you. You can take that one to the bank, but how often do we act like God is going to leave us and forsake us? Okay? And Jesus has promised to provide for all of our needs, and we even learned last week that even the adversity that we experience is going to be for good. That's who God is, and he's proven it again and again and again. He died on the cross for us. He is trustworthy. But yet we still worry. But God doesn't see worry as just little worry over there. He sees it as faithlessness, because that's what it is, at its root. What if your spouse or your friend was constantly worried about you betraying them or leaving them? Every day they woke up like that. Well, I'd probably have hurt feelings, right? I mean, haven't I shown that I'm faithful to you? I'm staying around here? Okay. But how often do we respond that way to God? We worry about what is happening tomorrow when God says it's all taken care of. Instead of worry, God challenges us to something else. Philippians 4, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. There's the command. Don't be anxious. Don't worry about anything. But then he gives you something to do instead. Because if you ever decided to stop worrying and do nothing else, okay, what's going to happen? You're going to start worrying again, right? You have to replace it with something different. And that's where prayer and thankfulness comes in, okay? You pour that out to God and leave it there. And then the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Don't let Jesus be amazed at our worry. Be amazed at our faithlessness when he has given us the freedom not to be. He's proven himself trustworthy. He's told us where this world is going. We need to trust him. So worry can take us into faithlessness. Let's talk about one more thing here. How about fear? Fear. We talked about this a couple weeks ago, so we won't spend too long here, but fear and faith don't mix together, do they? Where fear is evident, faith is not. Where faith is evident, fear is not. And for those people who understand that God is with us, they talk this way, the Lord is on my side, I will not fear, what can man do to me? Romans 8, if God is for us, who can be against us? The truth is that we do experience hardship in this life. But if we've trusted Jesus as our Savior, it doesn't matter what happens, God's going to take us all to the same goal, okay? That no matter what happens, we're all going to the same place through Christ. And that place is this, John 14. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you that I go to prepare a place for you. He says, and if I go, and he's assuming that yes, this is true, I am going. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am you may be also. And that is not something we should fear. The gift of heaven is not a consolation for the life tomorrow. It's meant to empower us today, okay, as well as tomorrow. And so we cling to what the Lord is doing, and therefore we don't fear because we trust God. his great power, and he's taken us, even if we experience hard things in this life, it's going to end in the same spot, okay, at his side. So we've seen worry, we've seen fear that can take us away from our faith. How about one more here? Think of complaining. Complaining. Starts with a C there for you kids. This is not something you can do with a strong faith, because complaining is just what? Expressing your dissatisfaction with something, correct? Okay. But if we have faith that God is working good in us, and we have faith that God is in control of this world, and He's moving us all to the same spot, do we have really anything to be dissatisfied about ultimately? I don't think we do. But it's hard, I understand. Earlier this week, again, my kids coming up here, I was complaining, okay? My kids woke up too early, and for my taste, okay? Before my alarm clock went off, and they were up, and they were not going back to bed, and I dragged myself out of bed, and I start, if somebody was there, I would have been complaining to them, but I was complaining to myself, why can't my kids just sleep in longer, okay? Why can't they just go back to bed, okay? And so I complained, but what is true in that moment as I'm tired and getting up with my kids? God is in control of this universe, right? And He saw it fitting for me to be up right then and there, okay? And if I trusted God, okay, I accept God for what He is doing in me and I respond in service to Him. Because God places in our lives opportunities to love and to serve other people, which He ends up rewarding, right? We're commanded to store up treasure in heaven where moth and rust do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. And so I had an opportunity in that moment as my kids were up at dawn, okay, that God has given me this chance to serve and love them, to build up reward for Him in heaven. And how can I say, God, how dare you give me opportunities to love and serve you and to store up reward for you, me in heaven? Okay, who would do that? All right? But I was blinded from that side of it, and I treated what was happening to me as an injustice, where God says, no, I'm working this world and for good in you. Because if you get down to it, we don't have anything to complain about because of what God has promised us. So, would your spouse or your friends say that you complain? Okay, I'm not going to ask you because I know what your answer is, but would your spouse and your friends say that you complain? Okay? If so, we need to look out for that. Jesus might just be amazed at the lack of our faith on a day-to-day basis because we just need to view our lives differently. Sometimes we got our eyes first on me and then everything else that happens. But the world is not about me, okay? It's not about you. It's about God and what He's doing, okay? And we align ourselves with what He's doing, and that gives us the strength to trust Him. So worry, fear, complaining, those are just some of the ways that we can show our lack of faith, and we need to be concerned about that because there's a cost. If we continue on in those things, there is a cost. Look at verse 5 again. In Nazareth, Jesus could do no mighty work there except that He laid His hands on a few sick people and He healed them. Jesus wanted to do great works there, but He couldn't do it because Jesus works in response to faith. And where there's not faith, what's the point? Okay? Without faith, there's no point in doing the miracle. And so He was limited in what He could accomplish because of the lack of faith of the people. And I think that can be true today as well. God is working in this world. He wants us to respond to Him in faith. And if we don't, I don't think we can have God's power or God's great blessing in our lives if we just respond in faithlessness all the time. Hebrews says that without faith, it's impossible to please God. And a Christian living his life without pleasing God, okay, is a Christian living his life without God's power, okay, without God's blessing to the extent that he could have it. And that's something to where Jesus could look at us and say, wow, I'm amazed. I thought this was my follower. He should be trusting me. So, just in close here. Is Jesus amazed by you? Okay, we learn from the centurion that we could have a strong faith and trust Him where He could look at us in a positive way to be amazed. But then we also learn from the people of Nazareth that He can be equally amazed at faithlessness. That the people that were supposed to believe in Him just do not. And maybe there's a chance that that might be us. Where we go to church, we hear sermons, we listen to good stuff on the radio, and we have the knowledge, but when life happens, we don't demonstrate that confidence in God. There's a disconnect between what happens at church and what happens in life. And then we often run to worry and fear and complaining as a replacement for the faith that God wants us to have. And that's so easy to do, but it is so deceptive. So here's the challenge. Will you make the choice to have faith? Okay? And whatever that situation is that you are dealing with right now, and it is a choice. Okay? And we have to make that choice because we don't feel like having faith. Okay? We feel like running to the worry, complaining, and the fear. That's what feels right. Okay? We have to make the choice to respond to God and make the choice that the Nazarenes did not do and make the choice that the centurion did do to respond to him in faith. Will you make that choice? And if you make the choice, it becomes just a little bit easier to do it next time and next time and next time as you develop a habit of going to God and his promises. He is trustworthy. Will you trust him? And as we close, I'd like us to take a time of quiet reflection, each person on their own. I want you to ask yourself this. What does faith look like in my situation? Okay, we all have different things that we're dealing with throughout the week, and you know what those hard areas are. What would faith look like if you made that choice and say, you know what, I'm actually going to trust God in this one, okay? I'm actually going to depend on him in this one. I'm going to respond to what the Bible says is true. And maybe God will look at you and be amazed at your faith rather than the lack of it. Right? So what does God want you to do with that this morning? Or maybe there's some here that haven't responded to that first step with God where you haven't even trusted Christ as your Savior. You need to make that first step of faith to ask God to forgive you of your sins. Okay? And you can do that right now. Because Christ says all who believe in him will have that eternal life. But for those of us who have that made that decision, are we following him on a daily basis in faith? Let's just take a few moments to reflect, and then I'll close us in prayer. Thank you. Father God, sometimes faith is a very, very hard choice to make. Lord, because it means giving up on responses and patterns maybe that we have spent years developing. Lord, right now, as people are challenged in their walk with you, Lord, I pray that you would give them your power, your strength, and that you would show up big for them in their area of struggle. Lord, and give them the knowledge that they need of your word to know what you have promised, and then to choose to believe it then as a result. Father God, just drive us to you, Father. And Lord, may we just live by faith and not by sight, as 2 Corinthians urges us to do. Father, be with us the rest of the day, Lord, and as each of us live our lives, help us to realize those moments where we can make that choice and choose to believe what you say rather than the natural response of our hearts. Father God, we just thank you for what you're doing in and through us in this church, and Lord, we ask your blessing upon the rest of the day. In your name I pray. Amen.